A Night at Hayes. By Bret Harte. Chapter 1. It was difficult to say if Hayes Farmhouse, or Hayes, as it was familiarly called, looked any more bleak and cheerless that winter afternoon than it usually did in the strong summer sunshine. Painted a cold merciless white, with scant projections for shadows, a roof of white pine shingles, bleached lighter through sun and wind, and covered with low, white-capped chimneys, it looked even more stark and chilly than the drifts which had climbed its low roadside fence, and yet seemed hopeless of gaining a foothold on the glancing walls, or slippery, wind-swept roof. The storm, which had already heaped the hollows of the road with snow, hurled its finely granulated flakes against the building, but they were whirled along the gutters and ridges, and disappeared in smoke-like puffs across the icy roof. The granite outcrop in the hilly field beyond had long ago whitened and vanished, the dwarf firs and larches which had at first taken uncouth shapes in the drift blended vaguely together, and then merged into an unbroken formless wave. But the gaunt angles and rigid outlines of the building remained sharp and unchanged. It would seem as if the rigors of winter had only accented their hardness, as the fierceness of summer had previously made them intolerable. It was believed that some of this unyielding grimness attached to Hayes himself. Certain it is that neither hardship nor prosperity had touched his character. Years ago his emigrant team had broken down in this wild but wooded defile of the Sierras, and he had been forced to a winter encampment, with only a rude log cabin for shelter, on the very verge of the promised land. Unable to enter it himself, he was nevertheless able to assist the better equipped teams that followed him with wood and water and a coarse forage gathered from a sheltered slope of wild oats. This was the beginning of a rude supply station which afterwards became so profitable that when spring came and Hayes' team were sufficiently recruited to follow the flood of immigrating gold seekers to the placers and valleys, there seemed no occasion for it. His fortune had been already found in the belt of arable slope behind the wooded defile, and in the miraculously located coign of vantage on what was now the great highway of travel and the only oasis and first relief of the weary journey. The breaking down of his own team at that spot had not only been the salvation of those who found at Hayes the means of prosecuting the last part of their pilgrimage, but later provided the equipment of returning teams. The first 2 years of this experience had not been without hardship and danger. He had been raided by Indians and besieged for 3 days in his stockade cabin, he had been invested by wintry drifts of 20 feet of snow, cut off equally from incoming teams from the pass and the valley below. During the second year his wife had joined him with 4 children, but whether the enforced separation had dulled her conjugal affection, or whether she was tempted by a natural feminine longing for the land of promise beyond, she sought it one morning with a fascinating teamster, leaving her 2 sons and 2 daughters behind her. 2 years later the elder of the daughters followed the mother's example, with such maidenly discretion, however, as to forbear compromising herself by any previous matrimonial formality whatever. From that day Hayes had no further personal intercourse with the valley below. He put up a hotel a mile away from the farmhouse that he might not have to dispense hospitality to his customers, nor accept their near companionship. Always a severe Presbyterian, and an uncompromising deacon of a far scattered and scanty community who occasionally held their service in one of his barns, he grew more rigid, sectarian, and narrow day by day. He was feared, and although neither respected nor loved, his domination and endurance were accepted. A grim landlord, hard creditor, close-fisted patron, and a smileless neighbor who neither gambled nor drank, old Hayes, as he was called, while yet scarce 50, had few acquaintances and fewer friends. There were those who believed that his domestic infelicities were the result of his unsympathetic nature, it never occurred to anyone, but himself probably, that they might have been the cause. In those Sierran altitudes, as elsewhere, the belief in original sin popularly known as pure cussedness dominated and overbore any consideration of passive, impelling circumstances or temptation, unless they had been actively demonstrated with a revolver. The passive expression of harshness, suspicion, distrust, and moroseness was looked upon as inherent wickedness. The storm raged violently as Hayes emerged from the last of a long range of outbuildings and sheds, and crossed the open space between him and the farmhouse. Before he had reached the porch, With its scant shelter, he had floundered through a snowdrift, and faced the full fury of the storm. But the snow seemed to have glanced from his hard angular figure as it had from his roof ridge, for when he entered the narrow hallway his pilot jacket was unmarked, except where a narrow line of powdered flakes outlined the seams as if worn. To the right was an apartment, half office, half sitting room, furnished with a dark and chilly iron safe, a sofa and chairs covered with black and coldly shining horsehair. Here Hayes not only removed his upper coat but his under one also, and drawing a chair before the fire sat down in his shirt sleeves. It was his usual rustic pioneer habit, and might have been some lingering reminiscence of certain remote ancestors to whom clothes were an impediment. He was warming his hands and placidly ignoring his gaunt arms in their thinly clad hickory sleeves, when a young girl of 18 sauntered, half perfunctorily, half inquisitively into the room. It was his only remaining daughter. Already elected by circumstances to a dry household virginity, her somewhat large features, sallow complexion, and tasteless, unattractive dress, did not obviously suggest a sacrifice. Since her sister's departure she had taken sole charge of her father's domestic affairs and the few rude servants he employed, with a certain inherited following of his own moods and methods. To the neighbors she was known as Miss Hayes, a dubious respect that, in a community of familiar Sallies, Mamies, Pussies, was grimly prophetic. Yet she rejoiced in the Oriental appellation of Zuleika. To this it is needless to add that it was impossible to conceive anyone who looked more decidedly Western. "Yakin put some things in my carpet baggage in the time the sled comes round," said her father meditatively, without looking up. "Then you're not coming back tonight?" asked the girl curiously. "What's going on at the summit, father?"
"I am," he said grimly.
"You don't reckon I calculate to stop dar? I'm going on as far as Horsley's to close up that contract afore the weather changes. I kinder allowed it was funny you'd go to the hotel tonight. There's a dance there, those two Weatherby girls and Mamie Harris passed up the road an hour ago on a wood sled, nigh blown to pieces and sitting up in the snow like skeered white rabbits." Hayes' brow darkened heavily. "Let em go," he said, in a hard voice that the fire did not seem to have softened. "Let em go for all the good their fool parents will ever get outer them, or the herd of wayside cattle they've let them loose among. I reckon they haven't much to do at home, or are hard put for company, to travel 6 miles in the snow to show off their prinkin to a lot of idle louts shiny with bear's grease and scented up with doctor's stuff," added the girl, shrugging her shoulders, with a touch of her father's mood and manner. Perhaps it struck Hayes at that moment that her attitude was somewhat monstrous and unnatural for one still young and presumably like other girls, for, after glancing at her under his heavy brows, he said, in a gentler tone, "Never you mind, Zuli. When your brother Jack comes home he'll know what's what, and have all the proper New York ways and style. It's nigh on 3 years now that he's had the best training Dr. Dawson's Academy could give, say in nothing of the powerful Christian example of one of the best preachers in the States. They mayn't he have worldly, ungodly fandangos where he is, and riotous livin', and scarlet abominations, but I've been told that they've tea circles, and assemblies, and harmony concerts of young folks and dancin', yes, fine square dancin' under control. No, I ain't stinted him in anything. You can remember that, Zuleika, when you hear any more gossip and backbiting about your father's meanness. I ain't spared no money for him."
"I reckon not," said the girl, a little sharply. "Why, there's that draft for $250 that came only last week from the doctors for extras."
"Yes," replied Hayes, with a slight knitting of the brows, "the doctor mout HEV writ more particulars, but parsons ain't a loose business men. I reckon these here extras were to push Jack along in the term, as the doctor knew I wanted him back here in the spring, now that his brother has got to be too stiff-necked and self-opinionated to do his father's work." It seemed from this that there had been a quarrel between Hayes and his eldest son, who conducted his branch business at Sacramento, and who had in a passion threatened to set up a rival establishment to his father's.
and it was also evident from the manner of the girl that she was by no means a strong partisan of her father in the quarrel. You'd better find out first how all the scholin and trainin' of Jack's is goin' to jibe with the ranch, and if he ain't been eddicated out of all knowledge of station business or care for it. New York ain't Hayes Ranch, and these yer assemblies and harmony doin's and their airs and graces may put him out of conceit with our plain ways. I reckon ye didn't take that to mind when you been hustlin' round payin' $250 drafts for Jack and quollin' with Bijah. I ain't sayin' nothin', father, only mebbe if Bijah had drafts and extras flourished around him a little more, mebbe he'd have been more polite and not so rough-spoken. Mebbe, she continued with a little laugh, even I'd be a little more in the style to suit Master Jack when he comes if I had $300 worth of convent scholin' like Mamie Harris. Yes, and you'd have only made yourself fair game for every schemin', lazy sport, or counter-jumper along the road from this to Sacramento, responded Hayes savagely. Zulika laughed again constrainedly, but in a way that might have suggested that this dreadful contingency was still one that it was possible to contemplate without entire consternation. As she moved slowly towards the door she stopped, with her hand on the lock, and said tentatively, I reckon you won't be wantin' any supper before you go? You're almost sure to be offered suthin' up at Horsley's, while if I have to cook you up suthin' now and still have the men's regular supper to get at 7, it makes all the expense of an extra meal. Hayes hesitated. He would have preferred his supper now, and had his daughter pressed him would have accepted it. But economy, which was one of Zulika's inherited instincts, vaguely appearing to him to be a virtue, interchangeable with chastity and abstemiousness, was certainly to be encouraged in a young girl. It hardly seems possible that with an eye single to the integrity of the larder she could ever look kindly on the blandishments of his sex, or, indeed, be exposed to them. He said simply, "Don't cook for me," and resumed his attitude before the fire as the girl left the room. As he sat there, grim and immovable as one of the battered fire dogs before him, the wind in the chimney seemed to carry on a deep-throated, dejected, and confidential conversation with him, but really had very little to reveal. There were no haunting reminiscences of his married life in this room, which he had always occupied in preference to the company or sitting room beyond. There were no familiar shadows of the past lurking in its corners to pervade his reverie. When he did reflect, which was seldom, there was always in his mind a vague idea of a central injustice to which he had been subjected, that was to be avoided by circuitous movement, to be hidden by work, but never to be surmounted. And tonight he was going out in the storm, which he could understand and fight, as he had often done before, and he was going to drive a bargain with a man like himself and get the better of him if he could, as he had done before, and another day would be gone, and that central injustice which he could not understand would be circumvented, and he would still be holding his own in the world. And the God of Israel whom he believed in, and who was a hard but conscientious providence, something like himself, would assist him perhaps some day to the understanding of this same vague injustice which he was, for some strange reason, permitting. But never more unrelenting and unsparing of others than when under conviction of sin himself, and never more harsh and unforgiving than when fresh from the contemplation of the divine mercy, he still sat there grimly holding his hand to a warmth that never seemed to get nearer his heart than that, when his daughter re-entered the room with his carpet bag. To rise, put on his coat and overcoat, secure a fur cap on his head by a woolen comforter, covering his ears and twined round his throat, and to rigidly offer a square and weather-beaten cheek to his daughter's dusty kiss, did not, apparently, suggest any lingering or hesitation. The sled was at the door, which, for a tumultuous moment, opened on the storm and the white vision of a horse knee-deep in a drift, and then closed behind him. Zulika shot the bolt, brushed some flakes of the invading snow from the mat, and, after frugally raking down the fire on the hearth her father had just quitted, retired through the long passage to the kitchen and her domestic supervision. It was a few hours later, supper had long passed, the hands had one by one returned to their quarters under the roof or in the adjacent lofts, and Zulika and the two maids had at last abandoned the kitchen for their bedrooms beyond. Zulika herself, by the light of a solitary candle, had entered the office and had dropped meditatively into a chair, as she slowly raked the warm ashes over the still smoldering fire. The barking of dogs had momentarily attracted her attention, but it had suddenly ceased. It was followed, however, by a more startling incident: a slight movement outside, and an attempt to raise the window. She was not frightened. Perhaps there was little for her to fear. It was known that Hayes kept no money in the house, the safe was only used for securities and contracts, and there were half a dozen men within call. It was, therefore, only her usual active, burning curiosity for novel incident that made her run to the window and peer out, but it was with a spontaneous cry of astonishment she turned and darted to the front door, and opened it to the muffled figure of a young man. "Jack! Saints alive! Why, of all things," she gasped, incoherently. He stopped her with an impatient gesture and a hand that prevented her from closing the door again. "Dad ain't here," he asked quickly. "No. When'll he be back?"
"Not tonight."
"Good," he said, turning to the door again. She could see a motionless horse and sleigh in the road, with a woman holding the reins. He beckoned to the woman, who drove to the door and jumped out. Tall, handsome, and audacious, she looked at Zulika with a quick laugh of confidence, as at some recognized absurdity. "Go in there," said the young man, opening the door of the office, "I'll come back in a minute." As she entered, still smiling, as if taking part in some humorous but risky situation, he turned quickly to Zulika and said in a low voice, "Where can we talk?" The girl held out her hand and glided hurriedly through the passage until she reached a door, which she opened. By the light of a dying fire he could see it was her bedroom. Lighting a candle on the mantel, she looked eagerly in his face as he threw aside his muffler and opened his coat. It disclosed a spare, youthful figure, and a thin, weak face that a budding mustache only seemed to make still more immature. For an instant brother and sister gazed at each other. Astonishment on her part, nervous impatience on his, apparently repressed any demonstration of family affection. Yet when she was about to speak he stopped her roughly. "There now, don't talk. I know what you're going to say. Could say it myself if I wanted to, and it's no use. Well then, here I am. You saw her? Well, she's my wife. We've been married 3 months. Yes, my wife. Married 3 months ago. I'm here because I ran away from school, that is, I haven't been there for the last 3 months. I came out with her last steamer. We went up to the Summit Hotel last night where they didn't know me until we could see how the land lay, before popping down on Dad. I happened to learn that he was out tonight, and I brought her down here to have a talk. We can go back again before he comes, you know, unless. But," interrupted the girl, with sudden practicality, "you say you ain't been at Dr. Dawson's for 3 months. Why, only last week he drew on Dad for $250 for your extras." He glanced around him and then arranged his necktie in the glass above the mantel with a nervous laugh. "Oh, that? I fixed that up, and got the money for it in New York to pay our passage with. It's all right, you know." Chapter 2. The girl stood looking at the ingenious forger with an odd, breathless smile. It was difficult to determine, however, if gratified curiosity were not its most dominant expression. "And you've got a wife and that's her," she resumed.
"Yes.
Where did you first meet her?"
"Who is she?"
"She's an actress mighty popular in Frisco, I mean New York. Lot o' chaps tried to get her, I cut 'em out. For all Dad's trying to keep me at Dawson's, I ain't such a fool, eh?" Nevertheless, as he stood there stroking his fair mustache, his astuteness did not seem to impress his sister to enthusiastic assent. Yet she did not relax her breathless, inquisitive smile as she went on. "And what are you going to do about Dad?" He turned upon her querulously.
"Well, that's what I want to talk about."
"You'll catch it," she said impressively. But here her brother's nervousness broke out into a weak, impotent fury. It was evident, too,
that in spite of its apparent spontaneous irritation its intent was studied.
Catch it? Would he?
Oh, yes. Well, she'd see who'd catch it. Not him. No, he'd had enough of this meanness, and wanted it ended. He wasn't a woman to be treated like his sister, like their mother, like their brother, if it came to that, for he knew how he was to be brought back to take Bija's place in the spring. He'd heard the whole story. No, he was going to stand up for his rights. He was going to be treated as the son of a man who was worth half a million ought to be treated. He wasn't going to be skimped, while his father was wallowing in money that he didn't know what to do with, money that by rights ought to have been given to their mother and their sister. Why, even the law wouldn't permit such meanness if he was dead. No, he'd come back with Lottie, his wife, to show his father that there was one of the family that couldn't be fooled and bullied, and wouldn't put up with it any longer. There was going to be a fair division of the property, and his sister Annie's property, and hers Zulika's too, if she'd have the pluck to speak up for herself. All this and much more he said. Yet even while his small fury was genuine and characteristic, there was such an evident incongruity between himself and his speech that it seemed to fit him loosely, and in a measure flapped in his gestures like another's garment. Zulika, who had exhibited neither disgust nor sympathy with his rebellion, but had rather appeared to enjoy it as a novel domestic performance, the morality of which devolved solely upon the performer, retained her curious smile. And then a knock at the door startled them. It was the stranger, slightly apologetic and still humorous, but firm and self-confident withal. She was sorry to interrupt their family council, but the fire was going out where she sat, and she would like a cup of tea or some refreshment. She did not look at Jack, but, completely ignoring him, addressed herself to Zulika with what seemed to be a direct challenge. In that feminine eye grapple there was a quick, instinctive, and final struggle between the two women. The stranger triumphed. Zulika's vacant smile changed to one of submission, and then, equally ignoring her brother in this double defeat, she hastened to the kitchen to do the visitor's bidding. The woman closed the door behind her, and took Zulika's place before the fire. "Well," she said, in a half-contemptuous toleration. "Well," said Jack, in an equally ill-disguised discontent, but an evident desire to placate the woman before him. "It's all right, you know. I've had my say. It'll come right, Lottie, you'll see." The woman smiled again, and glanced around the bare walls of the room. "And I suppose," she said, drily, "when it comes right I'm to take the place of your sister in the charge of this workhouse and succeed to the keys of that safe in the other room. It'll come all right, I tell you. You can fix things up here any way you'll like when we get the old man straight," said Jack, with the iteration of feebleness. "And as to that safe, I've seen it chock full of securities. It'll hold one less tonight," she said, looking at the fire. "What are you talking about?" he asked, in querulous suspicion. She drew a paper from her pocket. "It's that draft of yours that you were crazy enough to sign Dawson's name to. It was lying out there on the desk. I reckon it isn't a thing you care to have kept as evidence, even by your father." She held it in the flames until it was consumed. "By Jove, your head is level, Lottie," he said, with an admiration that was not, however, without a weak reserve of suspicion. "No, it isn't, or I wouldn't be here," she said, curtly. Then she added, as if dismissing the subject, "Well, what did you tell her?" "Oh, I said I met you in New York. You see, I thought she might think it queer if she knew I only met you in San Francisco 3 weeks ago. Of course I said we were married." She looked at him with weary astonishment. "And of course, whether things go right or not, she'll find out that I've got a husband living, that I never met you in New York, but on the steamer, and that you've lied. I don't see the use of it. You said you were going to tell the whole thing squarely and say the truth, and that's why I came to help you." "Yes, but don't you see, hang it all," he stammered, in the irritation of weak confusion, "I had to tell her something. Father won't dare to tell her the truth, no more than he will the neighbors. He'll hush it up, you bet, and when we get this thing fixed you'll go and get your divorce, you know, and we'll be married privately on the square. He looked so vague, so immature, yet so fatuously self-confident, that the woman extended her hand with a laugh and tapped him on the back as she might have patted a dog. Then she disappeared to follow Zuleika in the kitchen. When the two women returned together they were evidently on the best of terms. So much so that the man, with the easy reaction of a shallow nature, became sanguine and exalted, even to an ostentatious exhibition of those New York graces on which the paternal haze had set such store. He complacently explained the methods by which he had deceived Dr. Dawson, how he had himself written a letter from his father commanding him to return to take his brother's place, and how he had shown it to the doctor and been 3 months in San Francisco looking for work and assisting Lottie at the theater, until a conviction of the righteousness of his cause, perhaps combined with the fact that they were also short of money and she had no engagement, impelled him to his present heroic step. All of which Zuleika listened to with childish interest, but superior appreciation of his companion. The fact that this woman was an actress, an abomination vaguely alluded to by her father as being even more mysteriously wicked than her sister and mother, and correspondingly exciting, as offering a possible permanent relief to the monotony of her home life, seemed to excuse her brother's weakness. She was almost ready to become his partisan after she had seen her father. They had talked largely of their plans, they had settled small details of the future and the arrangement of the property, they had agreed that Zuleika should be relieved of her household drudgery, and sent to a fashionable school in San Francisco with a music teacher and a dressmaker. They had discussed everything but the precise manner in which the revelation should be conveyed to Hayes. There was still plenty of time for that, for he would not return until tomorrow at noon, and it was already tacitly understood that the vehicle of transmission should be a letter from the Summit Hotel. The possible contingency of a sudden outburst of human passion not entirely controlled by religious feeling was to be guarded against. They were sitting comfortably before the replenished fire, the wind was still moaning in the chimney, when, suddenly, in a lull of the storm the sound of sleigh bells seemed to fill the room. It was followed by a voice from without, and, with a hysterical cry, Zuleika started to her feet. The same breathless smile with which she had greeted her brother an hour ago was upon her lips as she gasped. "Lord, save us, but it's Dad come back. I grieve to say that here the doughty redresser of domestic wrongs and retriever of the family honor lapsed white-faced in his chair idealless and tremulous. It was his frillier companion who rose to the occasion and even partly dragged him with her. Go back to the hotel, she said quickly, and take the sled with you. You are not fit to face him now. But he does not know me, and I will stay. To the staring Zuleika, I am a stranger stopped by a broken sleigh on my way to the hotel. Leave the rest to me. Now clear out, both of you. I'll let him in. She looked so confident, self-contained, and superior, that the thought of opposition never entered their minds, and as an impatient rapping rose from the door they let her, with a half-impatient, half-laughing gesture, drive them before her from the room. When they had disappeared in the distance, she turned to the front door, unbolted and opened it. Hayes blundered in out of the snow with a muttered exclamation, and then, as the light from the open office door revealed a stranger, started and fell back. "Miss Hayes is busy," said the woman quietly, "I am afraid, on my account. But my sleigh broke down on the way to the hotel and I was forced to get out here. I suppose this is Mr. Hayes." A strange woman by her dress and appearance, a very worldling and even braver in looks and apparel than many he had seen in the cities, seemed, in spite of all his precautions, to have fallen short of the hotel and been precipitated upon him. Yet under the influence of some odd abstraction he was affected by it less than he could have believed. He even achieved a rude bow as he bolted the door and ushered her into the office. More than that, he found himself explaining to the fair trespasser the reasons of his return to his own home. For, like a direct man, he had a consciousness of some inconsistency in his return or in the circumstances that induced a change of plans which might conscientiously require an explanation. You see, ma'am, a rather singular thing happened to me after I passed the summit. 3 times I lost the track, got off it somehow, and found myself traveling in a circle. The 3rd time, when I struck my own tracks again, I concluded I'd just follow them back here. I suppose I might have got the road again by tryin' and fightin' the snow, but there's some things not worth the fightin'. This was a matter of business, and, after all, ma'am, business ain't everything, is it? He was evidently in some unusual mood, the mood that with certain reticent natures often compels them to make their brief confidences to utter strangers rather than impart them to those intimate friends who might remind them of their weakness. She agreed with him pleasantly, but not so obviously as to excite suspicion. And you preferred to let your business go, and come back to the comfort of your own home and family. The comfort of my home and family, he repeated in a dry, deliberate voice. Well, I reckon I ain't been tempted much by that. That isn't what I meant. But he went back to the phrase, repeating it grimly, as if it were some mandatory text. The comfort of my own home and family. Well, Satan hasn't set that trap for my feet yet, ma'am. No, yes, saw my daughter? Well, that's all my family, yes, see this room? That's all my home. My wife ran away from me, my daughter cleared out too, my eldest son as was with me here has quolled with me and reckons to set up a rival business age in me. No, he said, still more meditatively and deliberately, it wasn't to come back to the comforts of my own home and family that I faced round on Heavy Tree Hill, I reckon. As the woman, for certain reasons, had no desire to check this auspicious and unlooked for confidence, she waited patiently. Hayes remained silent for an instant, warming his hands before the fire, and then looked up interrogatively. A professor of religion, ma'am, or under conviction? Not exactly, said the lady smiling. Excuse me, but in spite of your fine clothes I reckoned you had a serious look just now. A reader of scripture, maybe. I know the Bible. You remember when the angel with the flaming sword appeared unto Saul on the road to Damascus? Yes. It mout have been suthin' in that style that stopped me, he said slowly and tentatively. Though nat rally I didn't see anything, and only had the queer feelin'. It might have been that shied my mare off the track. But Saul was up to some wickedness, wasn't he? Said the lady smilingly, while you were simply going somewhere on business. Yes, said Hayes thoughtfully, but my business might have seemed like persecution. I don't mind telling you what it was if you'd care to listen. But maybe you're tired. Maybe you want to retire. You know, he went on with a sudden hospitable outburst, you needn't be in any hurry to go, we can take care of you here tonight, and it'll cost you nothing. And I'll send you on with my sleigh in the morning. Perhaps you'd like suthin' to eat a cup of tea or I'll call Zulika, and he rose with an expression of awkward courtesy. But the lady, albeit with a self-satisfied sparkle in her dark eyes, here carelessly assured him that Zulika had already given her refreshment, and, indeed, was at that moment preparing her own room for her. She begged he would not interrupt his interesting story. Hayes looked relieved. Well, I reckon I won't call her, for what I was going to say ain't exactly the sort o' thing for an innocent, simple sort o' thing like her to hear. I mean, he interrupted himself hastily, that folks of more experience of the world like you and me don't mind speaking of. I'm sorter talking it for granted that you're a married woman, ma'am. The lady, who had regarded him with a sudden rigidity, here relaxed her expression and nodded. Well, continued Hayes, resuming his place by the fire, you see this here man I was goin' to see lives about 4 miles beyond the summit on a ranch that furnishes most of the hay for the stock that side of the divide. He's been holdin' off his next year's contracts with me, hopin' to make better terms from the prospects of a late spring and higher prices. He held his head mighty high and talked big of weight in his own time. I happened to know he couldn't do it. He put his hands on his knees and stared at the fire, and then went on. Yes, see, this man had had crosses and family trials. He had a wife that left him to join a lot of bally dancers and painted women in the Frisco playhouses when he was living in the southern country. You'll say that was like my own case, and maybe that was why it came to him to tell me about it, but the difference betwixt him and me was that instead of resting unto the Lord and finding him, and plucking out the eye that offended him cordin' to scripture, as I did, he followed after her trying to get her back, until, finding that wasn't no use, he took a big disgust and came up here to hide hisself, where there wasn't no playhouse nor play actors, and no women but Injun squaws. He preempted the land, and nat rally, there bain no one easy cared to live there but himself. He had it all his own way, made it pay, and, as I was saying before, held his head high for prices. Well, you ain't getting tired, ma'am? No, said the lady, resting her cheek on her hand and gazing on the fire, it's all very interesting, and so odd that you two men, with nearly the same experiences, should be neighbors. Say buyer and seller, ma'am, not neighbors at least scripturally nor friends. Well, now this is where the special providence comes in. Only this afternoon Jim Briggs, hearin' me speak of Horsley's offishness. Whose offishness? Asked the lady. Horsley's offishness. Horsley's the name of the man I'm talking about. Well, hearin' that, he says, you hold on, Hayes, and he'll climb down. That wife of his has left the stage, got sick of it, and is driftin' round in Frisco with some fellow. When Horsley gets to hear that, you can't keep him here. He'll settle up, sell out, and realize on everything he's got to go after her agin, you bet. That's what Briggs said. Well, that's what sent me up to Horsley's tonight to get there, drop the news, and then pin him down to that contract. It looked like a good stroke of business and a fair one, said the lady in an odd voice. It was so odd that Hayes looked up. But she had somewhat altered her position, and was gazing at the ceiling, and with her hand to her face seemed to have just recovered from a slight yawn, at which he hesitated with a new and timid sense of politeness. You're getting tired, ma'am. Oh dear, no, she said in the same voice, but clearing her throat with a little cough. And why didn't you see this Mr. Horsley after all? Oh, I forgot, you said you changed your mind from something you'd heard. He had turned his eyes to the fire again, but without noticing as he did so that she slowly moved her face, still half hidden by her hand, towards him and was watching him intently. No, he said, slowly, nothing I heard, something I felt. It mout have been that set me off the track. It came to me all of a sudden that he might be sitting there calm and peaceful like easy I might be here, heaven forgot all about her and his trouble, and here was me going to drop down upon him and start it all fresh agin. It looked a little like persecution, yes, like persecution. I got rid of it, saying to myself it was business. But I'd got off the road meantime, and had to find it again, and whenever I got back to the track and was pointed for his house, it all seemed to come back on me and set me off agin. When that had happened 3 times, I turned round and started for home. And do you mean to say, said the lady, with a discordant laugh, that you believe, because you didn't go there and break the news, that nobody else will? That he won't hear of it from the first man he meets. He don't meet anyone up where he lives, and only Briggs and myself know it, and I'll see that Briggs don't tell. But it was mighty queer this whole thing coming upon me suddenly, wasn't it? Very queer, replied the lady, for with the same metallic laugh, you don't seem to be given to this kind of weakness with your own family. If there was any doubt as to the sarcastic suggestion of her voice, there certainly could be none in the wicked glitter of her eyes fixed upon his face under her shading hand. But happily he seemed unconscious of both, and even accepted her statement without an ulterior significance. Yes, he said, communingly, to the glaring embers of the hearth, it must have been a special revelation. There was something so fatuous and one-ideaed in his attitude and expression, so monstrously inconsistent and inadequate to what was going on around him, and so hopelessly stupid if a mere simulation, that the angry suspicion that he was acting a part slowly faded from her eyes, and a hysterical smile began to twitch her set lips. She still gazed at him. The wind howled drearily in the chimney, all that was economic, grim, and cheerless in the room seemed to gather as flitting shadows around that central figure. Suddenly she arose with such a quick rustling of her skirts that he lifted his eyes with a start, for she was standing immediately before him, her hands behind her, her handsome, audacious face bent smilingly forward, and her bold, brilliant eyes within a foot of his own. "Now, Mr. Hayes, do you want to know what this warning or special revelation of yours really meant?" "Well, it had nothing whatever to do with that man on the summit." "No. The whole interest, gist, and meaning of it was simply this, that you should turn round and come straight back here." And she drew back and made him an exaggerated theatrical curtsy. "Have the supreme pleasure of making my acquaintance." That was all. "And now, as you've had it, in 5 minutes I must be off. You've offered me already your horse and sleigh to go to the summit. I accept it and go. Goodbye." He knew nothing of a woman's coquettish humor, he knew still less of that mimic stage from which her present voice, gesture, and expression were borrowed, he had no knowledge of the burlesque emotions which that voice, gesture, and expression were supposed to portray, and finally and fatally he was unable to detect the feminine hysteric jar and discord that underlay it all. He thought it was strong, characteristic, and real, and accepted it literally. He rose. "If you allow you can't stay, why I'll go and get the horse. I reckon he ain't been put up yet. Do, please." He grimly resumed his coat and hat and disappeared through the passage into the kitchen, whence, a moment later, Zuleika came flying. "Well, what has happened?" she said eagerly. "It's all right," said the woman quickly, "though he knows nothing yet. But I've got things fixed generally, so that he'll be quite ready to have it broken to him by this time tomorrow. But don't you say anything till I've seen Jack and you hear from him. Remember." She spoke rapidly, her cheeks were quite glowing from some sudden energy, so were Zuleika's with the excitement of curiosity. Presently the sound of sleigh bells again filled the room. It was Hayes leading the horse and sleigh to the door, beneath a sky now starlit and crisp under a northeast wind. The fair stranger cast a significant glance at Zuleika, and whispered hurriedly, "You know he must not come with me. You must keep him here." She ran to the door muffled and hooded, leaped into the sleigh, and gathered up the reins. "But you cannot go alone," said Hayes, with awkward courtesy. "I was Kulki Latin." "You're too tired to go out again, Dad," broke in Zuleika's voice quickly. "You ain't fit, you're all gray and crinkly now, like as when you had one of your last spells. She'll send the sleigh back tomorrow." "I can find my way," said the lady briskly, "there's only one turn off, I believe, and that leads to the stage station 3 miles west. You needn't be afraid of getting off on that, for you'll likely see the downstage crossing your road easy soon easy you get clear of the ranch." "Good night," said the lady. An arc of white spray sprang before the forward runner, and the sleigh vanished in the road. Father and daughter returned to the office. "You didn't get to know her, Dad, did ya?" queried Zuleika. "No," responded Hayes gravely, "except to see she wasn't no backwoods or mountaineering sort. Now, there's the kind of woman, Zuli, as knows her own mind and yours too, that a man like your brother Jack ought to pick out when he marries." Zulika's face beamed behind her father. "You ain't goin' to sit up any longer, Dad," she said, as she noticed him resume his seat by the fire. "It's getting late, and you look mighty tuckered out with your night's work." "Do you know what she said, Zuli?" returned her father, after a pause, which turned out to have been a long, silent laugh. "No. She said," he repeated slowly, "that she reckoned I came back here tonight to have the pleasure of her acquaintance." He brought his two hands heavily down upon his knees, rubbing them down deliberately towards his ankles, and leaning forward with his face to the fire and a long-sustained smile of complete though tardy appreciation. He was still in this attitude when Zuleika left him. The wind crooned over him confidentially, but he still sat there, given up apparently to some posthumous enjoyment of his visitor's departing witticism. It was scarcely daylight when Zuleika, while dressing, heard a quick tapping upon her shutter. She opened it to the scared and bewildered face of her brother. "What happened with her and father last night?" he said hoarsely.
"Nothing, why?"
"Read that? It was brought to me half an hour ago by a man in Dad's sleigh, from the stage station." He handed her a crumpled note with trembling fingers. She took it and read. "The game's up and I'm out of it. Take my advice and clear out of it too, until you can come back in better shape. Don't be such a fool as to try and follow me. Your father isn't one, and that's where you've slipped up. He shall pay for it, whatever he's done," said her brother with an access of wild passion.
"Where is he?"
"Why, Jack, you wouldn't dare to see him now."
"Wouldn't I?"
He turned and ran, convulsed with passion, before the windows towards the front of the house. Zuleika slipped out of her bedroom and ran to her father's room. He was not there. Already she could hear her brother hammering frantically against the locked front door. The door of the office was partly open. Her father was still there.
Asleep?
Yes, for he had apparently sunk forward before the cold hearth. But the hands that he had always been trying to warm were colder than the hearth or ashes, and he himself never again spoke nor stirred. ... It was deemed providential by the neighbors that his youngest and favorite son, alarmed by news of his father's failing health, had arrived from the Atlantic States just at the last moment. But it was thought singular that after the division of the property he entirely abandoned the ranch, and that even pending the division his beautiful but fastidious Eastern bride declined to visit it with her husband.